إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله، صلى على رسول الله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالًا كثيرًا ونساءً، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، إن أصطب الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار، ونعوذ بالله تعالى من النار. ثم ما بعد، we begin in the name of Allah سبحانه وتعالى، the most gracious, the most merciful, the all-seeing, the all-hearing, the all-knowing, the all-wise, the all-powerful. And we send the greatest of blessings upon the greatest of his creation, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear brothers and sisters, today I want to talk about a topic that perhaps we hear often, and perhaps we think of it often even, but when it comes to practicing it, maybe some of us fall short. What am I referring to here? Tawbah. Repentance. Returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now what I want to go over is, what does it mean to turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How do we repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How do we do it with sincerity? How can we do it in a way where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can come and accept it from us? But to talk about tawbah, we also need to understand the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So before I begin getting into repentance, I want to explain a little about the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the hadith Qudsi, it is mentioned, يَبْنَ آدَمَ إِنَّكَ مَا دَعَوْتَنِي وَرَجَوْتَنِي غَفَرْتُ لَكَ عَلَى مَا كَانَ فِيكَ وَلَا أُبَالِي. يا ابن آدم لو بلغت ذنوبك عنان السماء ثم استغفرتني غفرت لك ولا أبالي. يا ابن آدم إنك لو آتيتني بقراب الأرض خطايا ثم لقيتني لا تشرك بي شيئا لأتيتك بترابها مغفرة. This is in a hadith Qudsi. The translation meaning, O son of Adam, if you were to call upon me and place your hope in me, I would forgive you, and it does not bother me or burden me in any sort of manner. O son of Adam, if your sins were piling up to the clouds, and then you ask me for my forgiveness, I will forgive you, and it's no bother to me. O son of Adam, were you to come to me with sins to fill the earth, and then you come and you face me, and you believe in me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one and alone, I will come to you with enough forgiveness to fill the entire earth. Look at what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is stating here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in three different situations, explaining that he is capable of forgiving anything. And we as Muslims, we know that any sin can be forgiven other than shirk. If a person dies believing in more than one God, that's not acceptable. That can't be forgiven. Anything else can be forgiven. Murder, zina, alcohol, whatever you think of, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is capable of forgiving it. Because that is what it means to be the most merciful. When we say Allah is Ar-Rahman, we call Him the most merciful. This is what it means. And I'll explain more of it as we continue on. But here you see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you see His mercy. And it is because of that mercy we can come to repent to Him. Now I want to give an example. And always when it comes to giving examples, we try to give the best of examples. Something we can learn from. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has explained to us, as well as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and many Islamic scholars, in great detail, the story of Iblis. The story of Shaytan. Now it seems almost backwards that I'm mentioning him, right? I'm here talking about forgiveness and repentance and such, and here I am mentioning Shaytan. But allow me to explain. So Iblis, a Shaytan, we know that before he became a Shaytan, before he decided to lead people astray and such, he used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very, very well. To a very high extent. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rose him in ranks. And he kept rising and rising until eventually he was amongst the angels. Although he himself is a jinn. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gave the command. This is getting a little in detail now. But the jinn at that time were being corrupt. They were spreading mischief all over the earth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives the command to the angels that they go to war with these jinn. And so Iblis asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let me join them. Let me join the angels in fighting these corrupt jinn. And so he participates. And his rank keeps rising and rising. And then after this war is settled, most of the jinn defeated except for a few. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنِّي جَعَلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفًا. I am going to establish a khalifa, a leader, on the earth. And so Iblis is there and he thinks, I'm going to be that leader. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is setting everything up so that I can become the leader. I can become the khalifa of the earth. And so, he sees and he realizes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created a human being. And he says, right, we've created Adam. And before Adam, before the soul of Adam was blown into the body, Adam was just a mold, just a physical being, right? As if a corpse without a soul, a dead body almost. And so Iblis hears about this and he hears about Adam alayhi salam and how he is going to be the Khalifa and such, and he becomes very jealous. So he begins to tamper with the body of Adam, and then as the story progresses we know the life is blown into Adam, the soul is blown into Adam, and the angels are told to prostrate. So they all make sujood. Except for Iblis. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look at this instance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the command and told Iblis as well as all of the angels, bow down to Adam. All of the angels followed, Iblis refused to follow. And we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, He knows everything. So He already understood why Iblis refused to prostrate. But He gives Iblis a second chance and He said, Iblis, did you not hear me give the command and tell everyone to bow down to Adam? And so Iblis says, no, I heard the command, but I refuse to listen to it. I refuse to follow it. You made me from fire, you made him from clay, I'm better than him. Now we see his arrogance coming through. And so Iblis says this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him another chance. And he says, listen, are you sure? Paraphrasing here, of course. And he asks him, are you sure? You understand what you're doing. You understand what's going to be the consequence of doing this. And so Iblis says again, I refuse to prostrate to him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, okay, leave. Leave this high ranking that I gave you, and you are going to be from one of the cursed. But then Iblis says, wait, Ya Allah. Before you banish me, before you send me out, I have a request. Now mind you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already said it, you are now from the cursed. Iblis directly disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And yet he says, oh Allah, I have a request, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still listens to it. So he says, okay, what's your request? And he says, give me power, and give me influence over human beings, and allow me to live until the day of judgment, and grant me a kingdom, and so on and so on, so on. Very lengthy du'a. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, okay, you are granted such. I have given you this much. And so Iblis says, by your honor, right, by your honor, Ya Allah, I'm going to lead them astray. And here I am declaring war on them. And I'm going to sit on the straight path, your Sirat al-Mustaqim. And I'm going to wait there for them. And when they show up, I'm going to attack them from in front and from behind and from the left and the right. And I'm going to try to lead all of them astray. Here he's declaring war on humanity and he's disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know that all evil stems back to the shaitan. It all stems back to Iblis. And yet, as accursed as he is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala banished him. As unbelievably bad as shaitan is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still left the method out for him. And this is why I mentioned him. Because we all know Iblis is the worst being to exist. Nobody here can deny that. And yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still left a method for Iblis to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For Iblis to say, look, I made a mistake, I want to go back, and I want to ask forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And do you know what that is? To follow the initial command. To prostrate to Adam alayhi salam. And scholars mention this. That if Iblis alayhi salam were to go to the grave of Adam and prostrate to it, and make a sincere repentance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would forgive him. And how do we compare to Iblis in terms of evil? We're nothing. We are nothing compared to the evil of Iblis. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu tubu ila Allahi tawbatan nasuha. عَسَى رَبُّكُمْ أَنْ يُكَفِّرَ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ وَيُدْخِلُكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ يَوْمَ لَا يَخْزِ اللَّهُ النَّبِيَّ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعْهُ نُورُهُمْ يَسْعَى بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَبِأَيْمَانِهِمْ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا أَتْمِمْ لَنَا نُورَنَا وَاغْفِرْ لَنَا إِنَّكَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, mentioning the dua of the people in the next life. And he's explaining to us the virtue of repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe, Tubu ila Allahi tawbatan nasuha. Repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a sincere repentance, a serious repentance, a genuine repentance. عَسَى رَبُّكُمْ أَن يُكَفِّرَ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ. Perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you of your sins. وَيُدْخِلَكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. And He will grant you entry into paradise, into a jannah, in which the rivers flow from beneath. يَوْمَ لَا يَخْزُ اللَّهُ النَّبِيَّ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعْهُ. On the day, referring to the day of judgment. On the day on which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not embarrass or humiliate the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and those who believed with him. نورهم يسعى بين أيديهم وبأيمانهم. Their light is shining from in front of them and from all around them. يقولون ربنا أتمم لنا نورنا واغفر لنا. They will say, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, forgive for us our sins and perfect for us our light, this nur that you grant to us. إنك على كل شيء قدير. Indeed, you are powerful over everything. You are capable of anything. Look at all of the virtues and the rewards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning in this one verse, just one verse. And all of it stemming from repentance, and only repentance. Look at the virtue that repentance holds. And I'll give one more example before we end the first part of the khutbah at least. And that is the example of Fir'aun. Again, right? Purposely selecting the harshest of examples. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam describes Fir'aun to be the biggest tyrant ever. Before I continue, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا قِيلَ لَكُمْ تَفَسَّحُوا فِي الْمَجَالِسِ فَفْسَحُوا يَفْسَحِ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. All you who believe, when it is told to you to make space and to move up, then please do so. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make space for you. So please, brothers and sisters, move up. Try to create the most space that you can. There are still people coming in, and we need all the space that we have, inshallah. So the example of Fir'aun, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam describes him as the biggest tyrant to ever exist. This was a man who enslaved Bani Israel. This was a man who told his people to believe in him as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to believe that he was God. And whenever anyone would disobey, or anyone would say otherwise, he would persecute them. And there are many examples of him doing so. Him trying to publicly humiliate the Prophet Musa alayhi salam. Him attacking Musa and Bani Israel alayhi salam. And I'll even give you a specific example where once the hairstylist of Fir'aun's daughter was combing her hair. And she accidentally drops the comb, so she goes to pick it up and she says, Bismillah. So the daughter asks, you mean my father? And she says, no. The hairstylist says, no, I'm talking about Allah. My Lord and your Lord, your father's Lord, Lord of the heavens and the earth. And so she says, can I report this to my father? Can I tell this to my father? And the hairstylist tells her, go ahead. And so Fir'aun summons this hairstylist later, after hearing this. And he's with his advisor. And he asks her, oh hairstylist, who is your Lord? And she says, Allah is my Lord and your Lord, Lord of the heavens and the earth. So Fir'aun smiles. And he says, okay. So then the next day, she goes home and she finds that Fir'aun has taken her three kids captive. And there's a huge cauldron, right? Basically a very big pot. And it's filled with boiling water. And so he asks her again, and she understands the situation. So he asks her again, who is your Lord? And she says, Allah is my Lord, and your Lord, Lord of the heavens and the earth. So he tosses the first child in. And then he asks again, grabbing the second child, who is your Lord? And now she's hesitating a little. Right? It hurt her. She just witnessed her child die in front of her. And she says, Allah is my Lord and your Lord, Lord of the heavens and the earth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so Fir'aun tosses the second child in. Then they grab the baby, the last child. And Fir'aun says, who is your Lord? And she's there and she's hesitating. She can't get herself to say it because she understands. The moment she says it, that baby is dead. So she's hesitating and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates a miracle. And he has the baby speak. And the baby says, oh my mother, Ya Ummi, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid, because us, we are in Al-Jannah. We are in paradise. to reaffirm her heart. So she says, Allah is my Lord and your Lord. And so Fir'aun tosses the baby in, and he tosses the woman in as well, killing the whole family. So Fir'aun, the biggest tyrant, just as the Prophet ﷺ described him, as evil as this man was, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still left the method of repentance for him too. And this is why I'm giving these severe examples. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left a method for him too, if he just claimed to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is mentioned that when the Prophet Musa alayhi salam opened the sea, and as him and Bani Israel traveled across, Fir'aun and his followers chasing after them. Eventually the sea closes on Fir'aun and his followers and they're drowning. So Fir'aun comes and he decides this is going to be the moment. He realizes he's dying. He understands that he's about to die. So he says, and it's mentioned in the Quran, I have come to believe in the Lord of the heavens and the earth, the Lord that Bani Israel has come to believe in. But it's also mentioned in the Quran, Allah's response, Al-an, now? You waited all the way up until now. And Fir'aun knew the truth as well, but he continuously denied it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, now, when you used to spread mischief amongst the earth, and you were from the corrupt, now you try to repent? Jibreel alayhi salam mentions to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam much later that when this incident happened and Fir'aun came to say the shahada, essentially to say that he believes in Allah, Jibreel said, I went there myself and I grabbed the dirt from the floor and I threw it in his mouth. And he said, I was throwing it in his mouth to make sure he couldn't make the statement, because wallahi I feared if he finished making that statement, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would forgive him. Can you imagine? SubhanAllah. This is what it means to be the most merciful. Jibreel alayhi salam was so scared that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would forgive him over one statement. Despite this man going around and telling everyone that he is Allah, enslaving people, killing people, and so forth. And one simple testament, one simple statement, and he could have been forgiven. وَقُولِ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ إِنَّهُ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. So now I've given these two examples with the Iblis and Fir'aun. Two of the worst of creation, two of the worst of beings to ever exist. As an example for us to understand that there is no such thing as us not being forgiven. Perhaps some of us think, and there are Muslims who think that, you know, I have done something wrong, even if it's a major sin. And they think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is incapable of forgiving them. Wallahi, He is. That is what it means to be the most merciful, the most powerful. And here I'm giving examples with Fir'aun and with Iblis to show everyone here that it is very much capable. It is very much possible. But now back to the initial question. How do we make a sincere repentance? How do we make a repentance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can accept? The scholars mentioned that there are three categories to breaking this down. Right? So firstly, obviously we have to understand, before even these three steps, that it's possible for us to be forgiven so that we could try to repent. So now getting into the three points. Or if you want to simplify it, the three R's. Right, the letter R, the three R's. The first one, regret. Now what do I mean by this? If you are going to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to regret the action that you were doing. You have to understand that what you were doing wasn't good, it wasn't right, and that you shouldn't be doing it. So that's the first R. Regretting the action. Because that is what leads to the second and the third. The second being, refrain. Now what do I mean by refrain? You stop doing the action. Can you stop doing the action if you think it's okay? No. You have to regret the action. You have to understand that this action is bad, that you can't be doing it. And then you come to understand, okay, because this is bad, I need to stop doing it. And then lastly, refuge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's refuge. Constantly make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Always ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant you protection, to guide you, to make sure that He doesn't let you go back to these things. So these are the three R's, my brothers and sisters, for how to make a proper repentance. Right? Regret, regretting the action. Refraining, right? Don't do the action anymore. And then refuge, seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's protection. And I'll end with this. The dua from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, known as Sayyid al-Istighfar. The greatest of du'ats meant to ask for forgiveness. Allahumma anta rabbi wa rabbuna. Allahumma anta rabbi. I'll stick with the individual version. Allahumma anta rabbi. Oh Allah, you are my Lord. La ilaha illa ant. There is no God, there is no deity, there is no one worthy of worship other than you. خَلَقَتَنِي وَأَنَا عَبْدَكَ. You created me and I am your servant, I am your slave. وَأَنَا عَلَى عَهْدِكَ وَوَعْدِكَ مَسْتَطَعَ. And I am on your promise, I am on your path, I am on your truth to the best of my ability. Here you see the sort of regret phase. You see the submission. Right? But then the dua continues. اللهم انت ربي لا اله الا انت خلقتني وانا عبدك وانا العهد وانا على عهدك ووعدك ما استطعت اعوذ بك من شر ما صنعت. Here we begin to seek refuge. اعوذ بك من شر ما صنعت. I seek refuge from you, I seek your protection from what it is that I'm doing, from what it is that I'm creating. اعوذ بك من شر ما صنعت. ابوء لك بنعمتك علي. I bear witness, I acknowledge your blessings upon me. وَأَبُوءُ لَكَ بِذَنْبِي. And I bear witness and I acknowledge my own sins, my own mistakes, my own shortcomings. فَغْفِرْ لِي. So forgive me. فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَغْفِرَ ذُنُوبَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ. Because verily nobody can forgive anything except for you. The only one who can forgive me is you. And if you look at this dua, this one dua alone, Sayyid al-Istighfar, the greatest of the du'ats meant for seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It covers regretting the action that you are doing, and it covers seeking refuge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the only thing that's left from the three R's is what you have to do to stop committing the action. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us all capable of repenting to Him. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us stop our bad habits and to replace them with good and better habits, bismillah. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا. ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا. ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به. واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا. أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. وأقم الصلاة.